Thou rushing wind, the rushing wind that are so strong, he clouds that sail in heaven long. Oh, praise him, hallelujah. Thou rushing morning, praise your joy. Ye lights of evening, find a voice, sing, oh, praise him. Oh, praise. Oh, praise him. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, ye ones of tender heart, forgiving others, take your part. Oh, sing ye, hallelujah. Ye who long pain and sorrow bear, praise God and on him cast your care. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Hallelujah. 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 Their creator bless and worship him in humbleness. Oh, praise him, hallelujah. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise him, oh, praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Sing, oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Sing, oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Sing, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
This morning by singing hallelujah, saying thank you for your promises. Thank you, you make your promises. That you say to us, these things I will do. That you actually extend yourself to us and say, trust me. And more than that, thank you that you finish the things you start. That when you make promises, you fulfill those promises. And so specifically for those of us who are waiting still, for things that you said you would do, may this hallelujah for us this morning be a hopeful one for the things we've been waiting to see you do, that our disappointment and our frustration would lead us back to you instead of away from you, that we would return again and say, bring the justice you said you would bring. Bring the reconciliation you said you would bring. Bring the peace you said you would bring. That we would return to you and sing hallelujah. Thank you for your promises, and thank you for doing the things you said you would do. Let's do that one more time. Sing, oh, praise him.
Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sing, oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, sing hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
pretty well. We'll do another one. That's how I'll do for the most part of the morning. I'll just continue to do another thing until it just stops working. Good. Awesome. I mean, I have a plan. I'm just not going to stick to it unless it keeps working. You sing this with me?
Our Father everlasting, your creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. Resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus.
Our judge
and our defender, suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. River seated high,
I believe in God our Father.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. In the resurrection, and we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in life eternal, I believe in the virgin birth, I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three. One, I believe in the resurrection, and we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Yes, I believe in the name of Jesus. Yes, I believe in the name of Jesus.
Lord Jesus, we want our theology to not just be a thing agreed upon in our minds, like some sort of cognitive resolution, but that would be a thing that lives in our feet and in our hands, that our theology would be fully expressed in the way we live our lives rather than just the things that we think and say. We want our theology to be embodied. You were embodied. You weren't an idea. You aren't an idea. You live. And so we want to live you in the same ways we think of you. We want our bodies and minds, our relationships, to be devoted to you. I have in more recent years been looking at, and when I'm choosing songs for congregational singing, look at songs from the Black church tradition and doing my own little Caucasian versions of them. There is something to be said for a lived theology that is a kind of defiant lived theology. To say I believe these things, to live my belief in these things, but to do so in a way that contrasts my life against whether it's the injustice or the slowness or the frustrations of the world. And so this song, by old song, by a gentleman named Homo Morris. It's a simple song in its structure, but it is a deep, deep song in its history, written by and sung by folks who were clearly moved to say, I will not be moved from the places that I've been planted in the gospel of Jesus Christ. There is a courage in these songs that I want for my own life, and I want to extend this to us this morning.
I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by water, I shall not be moved.
On my way to glory land.
On my way to glory land, I shall not be moved. On my way to glory land, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the water, I shall not be moved, just like a tree planted by water. I shall not be moved.
Though the tempest rages,
though the tempest rages,
sing it out.
On this rock of ages, just like a tree planted by water, I shall not be moved.
I shall not be.
I shall not be. I shall not be moved. I shall not be. I shall not be. Just like a tree planted by water, I shall not be moved. In His love abiding, and in Him confiding, just like a tree planted by water, I shall not be moved.
You sing it out. Here we go.
I shall not be. I shall not be. Just like a tree it's planted by water,
just like a tree,
just like a tree planted by water, I shall not be moved.
Amen. Amen. Go ahead and grab a seat.
Well, good morning. It is good to see all of you. Thank you for choosing to be in chapel this morning. It is an intentional act. You have to actually choose to be here, and we're glad that you are here this morning. Before I introduce our wonderful person who's leading us in worship and in the word this morning, let me just give a special welcome. We have some special guests with us from Evangelical Seminary in Myerstown, PA. No strangers to Eastern University, because both of them have a unique connection with Eastern. President Tony Blair, who's been a colleague here for a number of years. We're grateful that you're here, Tony. We're grateful. And also Academic Dean Jim Ehrman. We're grateful that he is here. He's a PhD student in our organizational leadership. I was at a conference back in the spring, sponsored by the CCCU, and I was able to reconnect with our speaker, worship leader this morning, Justin McRoberts. and it was wonderful to get reconnected. And after hearing him and listening to him, I said, let's invite him to Eastern University, sponsored by Compassion International. Justin flew in yesterday from an area outside of Oakland, California. So he's doing really well. He's conscious. No, he's doing well. Justin is an author, songwriter, pastor, overall good guy. And I want us to really respond to what he has prepared for us this morning. We were going to have an opportunity even to be able to respond in a way of child sponsorship through Compassion International. We thank, and we do this once a year, and we've been doing Compassion International over 30 years here in Chapel. And we're grateful to our two volunteers, Bryn and Margaret, who are here. Actually, Bryn is a student at Messiah College who came here to Easton to work this morning. So you should applaud on that note. That's a good thing. I don't know. Okay. But let's welcome Justin McRoberts as he continues this morning.
One, two, three. Yeah, there it is. That sound, that's because my skull is empty. Second chapter of Mark, one of my favorite accounts and stories of Jesus. It begins with these four friends who have a fifth friend. Their fifth friend doesn't have the use of his arms or his legs. Mark calls him a paralytic. And these four friends, as four friends do, when they're hanging out together, they hatch a plan. And this plan is to get their friend across town to where it's rumored that Jesus is teaching. And the thought, apparently, is if they can get him all the way across town to where Jesus is teaching, then maybe Jesus will do one of these miraculous works that they've heard rumor of. And so they put their friend on a mat, and they pick up the mat, and they carry him across town. My favorite character in the story, honestly, is Brother on the Mat, because he's kind of the central character in the story, and he has no lines. Like, and I resonate with that, because I'm like, it's my life. Why do I have so little say as to how it's going? And so they pick him up, they carry him across town. And the way Mark describes this moment is they get to this building, and it is so crowded, they can't get in. And if that's four guys like me, it's like the end, it's the shortest, saddest story in the Gospels. And it ends like, and lo, they walked away sadly, chapter 3. Like, that's how, like, that's it. End the story. But thank God, quite literally, like, it wasn't four dudes like me. They had at least one crazy friend with them. And if you are the crazy friend, thank you. Thank you for being the crazy friend. If you have a crazy friend in your life, you know how important that is. And if you don't, go get you a crazy friend. The crazy friend is the friend that, like, takes everything just a little bit too far. And by too far, I mean it becomes fun. Like, the crazy friend is a friend that says on Thanksgiving, like, yeah, it'd be cool to go out and play football. What would be better is if we did it with the turkey. That would be more interesting. That would be memorable. Everyone plays football. No one plays with a turkey. That's the crazy friend. So, the crazy friend, because four guys like me, we come to the door and we're like, oh, man, bummer. Well, it's the thought that counts, right, bro? Right? The crazy friend goes, oh, I've got an idea. And the next thing you know, these folks are on the roof. And I don't know how you get a paralyzed man on a rooftop in the first century, but I can tell you it takes a crazy friend. So now these folks are on the roof, and they're trying to figure out that if the front door is here, then maybe Jesus would potentially be standing around here, which is when phase two of crazy friend's plan goes into effect, and they start cutting a hole in this poor sucker's roof. Now, here's a guy who, like, invited Jesus into his home or whatever for, like, Bible study and snacks. And dude just got a sunroof he did not order. cutting a hole. And like, we tell and hear these stories so much that I know I do. I lose touch with kind of the radical nature of these moments because I've heard them so often. So let's put pause on my teaching here for a second, and I'll say it like this. Like this morning, as I'm standing here talking and I'm holding the remote and everything's in perfect control, we hear footsteps on the roof. A good number of footsteps. Folks walking around on the roof. And what sounds like, you know, a body being dragged around on the roof. And as we're trying to navigate what might be happening above us on the roof, debris from the roof begins to fall onto the floor in front of me. And as we look up through the dust and debris of the roof, we see four heads poke through the hole. Friends, if that were to happen this morning, here's the thing that no one in the room says, okay? No one in the room looks up through that hole and goes, oh, what faith they have. No, you don't. Not a chance. You absolutely don't. You're like, get off the roof! You ruined the roof. Like, that's what, like, we don't go to, like, faith. We're going, like, you're, what are you, nuts? And there is something to that, right? There's something to that. There's something to folks like having to pause and question you. Like, what are you doing with your time? What are you doing with your life? Like, why would you continue to give yourself to a world that gives you so little back? That's lunacy. See, what I'm beginning to understand at 42 years old is that faith can look like, and maybe sometimes should look like, a little bit like lunacy. Man, that's nuts. Why would you give yourself another chance with that person who has betrayed you? Why would you seriously let that person back in your life? I believe in Jesus Christ, and I believe in the resurrection. Sometimes faith looks like lunacy. And so these lunatics are on the roof. And so there they are. They're sort of, you know, they begin to lower their friend through the hole. Which, again, as a side note, this is the point in which the story, you realize there's at least one woman involved in this plan. Because, like, I can see four guys hatching a plan to carry their friend across town. I can see four guys picking their buddy up and doing that. I can definitely see four guys climbing on the roof. I can definitely see four guys cutting a hole in someone's roof without permission. But I think that's the point at which, like, male ingenuity runs completely out of gas. Because we'd have been like, I didn't think about the distance from the roof to the floor. We're going to have to drop you. It's all right, we came to bring him healed, so it's, you know. Like, that's how it goes. But there's at least one woman involved in this plan, and maybe she's a little bit like my mom. My mom who has that purse with everything imaginable in it. And maybe your mom's like that. It's like, gosh, Mom, if I had a crescent wrench. You know what's funny? Is I actually have a crescent. I'm like, why do you have a crescent wrench? And there's a gal on the roof. She's like, you know what's strange? Is I've been carrying on 600 feet of twine for years. And today it's just so useful. You know, like, now they're lowering this guy through the roof. And he's lying on the mat looking up through this hole. And imagine being this guy looking up through this hole at his friends and thinking about, like, what?
Love.
Woo! That's right. Let's pray. Think about what love it takes for these guys to do, for his friends to have done with it. Think about, like what might happen on the other side of potentially being healed. Thinking about, like, all the effort that they've put into this day. Thinking about all the times that he's seen them drop things. But he doesn't, right? He doesn't get dropped. He gets set down at the feet of Jesus. And I'm going to suggest that it's at this point that the story takes its actually most radical turn. Because, and this is part of why, not part of why, this is one of the many reasons why I read the scriptures over and over and over again. Because I don't see the same things in every season. Can I get an amen?
Amen?
Sometimes my heart needs to see something in a season, and sometimes my eyes just don't see it. And sometimes Jesus just cracks my skull open and says, this is what this season's about. And I noticed this just more recently, paying attention to the scripture. Jesus says nothing to the man on the ground. He says nothing about his physical condition. He says nothing about his spiritual condition. What Mark says, as soon as this guy's laid at his feet, he looks up through the hole, and Mark says he saw their faith. And in response to their faith, he turned to the man on the ground and he said, "Your sins are forgiven. Take up your mat and walk." In response to the faith of his friends, Jesus reconciled this man to the Father and healed him. And you've been there. You've been there when someone else's faith carried you to the feet of Jesus because you could not get there on your own. You've been there when someone else's strength carried you for a season because you had run out of your own. You've been there when someone else's vision of who you are in Christ was more important than your own interpretation of your own life because you had quit on you and someone else didn't. This is why we do this thing together, because you don't have what it takes to get through on your own. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And one of the ways we get carried by Jesus is that we carry one another, because you've been on the other side of that as well, whether you know it or not. Someone watched you and said, if she can make it, I can make it. I've been ruined by this thing. I'm in this moment of depression. She's on the other side of it. That gives me hope because I know she trusts in Jesus and he carried her through. I'm in the midst of this thing where I've got this eating disorder. I've got this credit card addiction. I've got this thing going on and I don't know how to mess with this myself, but I see her, I see him, and I see what Jesus has done with them, and their faith, their strength, will carry me through the season. You've been on either side of this thing because this is just the way it works. This is the way he has designed it. We carry each other. Probably the best example of this I've ever seen is this young man right down here in the front. His name is Deep Halder. I met Deep Halder at his school just outside of Calcutta, India. Now, most of the kids in his village don't get to go to school. There's really no such thing as public education in his region of the world. And so when I say I met him at his school, I actually met him at this church that has put together a school for the kids that live in his area. The vast majority of these kids don't get access to education or medicine or daily food, but this church has decided that your geography shouldn't dictate your destiny.
Amen.
That where you're born in the world shouldn't dictate how you live and how you are loved. See, in his region of the world, and so many of us know the story of the Dalit caste and the folks who've been sort of cast aside by their families and by their government, but there's this group of Christians at this church, and there's this 16-year-old girl at the time of the story who sponsors him through compassion, and they believe of him something very different than his government, his world does, that he's a beloved son of living God, and that he ought to have a chance at life like you and I do. And so because of these Christians and because of this sponsor, kids just like Deep Halder are being lowered through the whole of India's culture and laid at the feet of Jesus every single day to be reconciled to the Father and to be healed. So he's bouncing around from one side of this little schoolhouse to the other. And he's like, this is where I sit down, we do my homework. And he goes, this over here is when the doctor comes. She sits on the stool and she helps us feel better. Again, the vast majority of the kids in his area don't get to see doctors. He said, I eat every day and I stand here and we get fed in line and we sit over here. And he's just so excited to show us about all this stuff that he gets to do. And this is what I'm drawing. And here are the letters from my sponsor and all these things. Just so thrilled with this life he's living. And then he says this. Would you like to meet my family? Like, yeah, we'd love to meet your family. That sounds great. So we walk about a mile and a half down the road into this little space. And when I say little, I mean little. Like it's like maybe about twice the size of this stage area. So my back is against the wall against the post when I took this picture. That's the whole size of the thing. And there are 8 folks living in there, most of his family, cousins, etc. Deep Halder's mom. And when we go into this little hut, and I have to duck, which makes me feel good. Like I'm 5'6". I like being with smaller people. I loved India. It was, so I have to duck to get into this place, and I'm standing against the back wall, and Deep Halder's father reaches out and grabs my hand. That's Deep's father just off to Deep Halder's right shoulder on your left. And Deep Halder's father says, can I tell you a story about my son? Of course, when he says it, he doesn't say it in English. He says it in the dialect of Hindi, and I have to get the translation, which had been kind of a journey. We had a translator up to, we were with the pastor of the church this day, because everything Compassion does happens through a local church. But the day before, we had a translator that didn't speak the exact dialect of Hindi that was like prevalent in the region. And apparently there's several hundred dialects of Hindi. And so legitimately had this moment where we're in another household and I ask a question like, you know, do you have other family in the area? And the translator talks and the family talks and they're sort of conversing for a while, about 7 or 8 minutes. The answer comes back and she says, the family says they do not like fish. Great. That's cool. I'm more of a chicken man. Can you, never mind, drop it. So the pastor of this church translates this story. And Deepal, this father, says that he says, you'll notice I'm very thin. He said, I'm not thin because I don't eat regularly. I've actually been eating more regularly for the last few months. But until 6 months ago, for about a year, I couldn't use my arms or my legs. And I looked at the translator and said, are you saying that he is saying that he was paralyzed for a year? And Deep's father says that because of his place in the caste system as a member of what used to be called the Dalit caste, you're not allowed to hire members of the Dalit caste. It's socially unacceptable. So he couldn't get a job. But there was this person in their church, I love this, there was a person in this church that hosts the program where his son goes to school that hired him under the table, because sometimes love breaks the right rules. Can I get an amen? Amen. Unfortunately, as Deepal's father was working as this electrician's apprentice, he slipped and fell off a rooftop and landed on his shoulder and his neck. They carried him to the hospital. At the hospital, and the pastor was showing us the sort of like picture story of what happened. And there was a picture of him at the hospital where they had turned him away because he was a member of the Dalit caste. So they just sent him home. And he said, and you can't see it in this picture, but behind he and his wife who's standing behind him, there's this little red mat. He said, I lay here on this mat for about a year, and my family did their best to take care of me. He says, and we didn't know how we're going to make it. Then he says this, but my son. And friends, like anytime someone's telling you a story about Jesus Christ and it's a little bit dark and then they say, but, it's about to get really, really good. Amen. Because the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ. We didn't know how we were going to make it, he said, but my son was getting letters from his sponsor. See, Deepalder had written to this 16-year-old girl, this Canadian girl, a Canadian, friends, of all things, a Canadian, and said, this is what's going on in our household, my father, and he's hurt himself, and she started writing these letters. See, when you sponsor a kid with compassion, the way it basically works is, this is the only place in the world that this packet exists. This is Zare, her birthday is actually tomorrow. Zare, this is the only place in the world the packet exists, because like, getting fed is wonderful. Getting an education is tremendous. Being able to see a doctor when you need a doctor, all that is essential. But relationships in Jesus Christ change lives for eternity. So like, I want to make sure kids get to eat, but I really want to make sure kids get the gift of you. Like, you're the gift Jesus gave the world. So this teenage girl starts writing him these stories from the scriptures about Jesus healing people. And Deep's father says, we never heard anything like it. There's something like 300 million gods in the Hindu religion. Truth be told, none of those gods care for their people. Jesus Christ does. We never heard anything like it. So my son, he says, he believed the words of these letters. He believed the words of these stories. And so he got up and he walked to the pastor's house in the middle of the night and knocked on the door. Take a cue. Knocked on the pastor's door and said, will you come pray for my father the way they do in the Bible? And the pastor gathered some of the kids in his household. And they walked about a mile down. And Deep's father tells the story like this. He said, they walked into the hut and they came around me and they knelt down. And they put their hands on my body. The word Dalit used to mean untouchable. And he said, they put their hands on my body and they prayed for me in the name of Jesus. And then he says, so after I got up, my family and I were talking. And I said, can you go back to the part where you got up? Because I think that's significant. He said, yes, they prayed for me in the name of Jesus. And so I stood up and I said, okay. He says, but what I want you to know, because there was a important, it was a part that he thought was more important, and this is what he said. But what I want you to know is my family and I, we talked about it in the days afterwards, and what we decided is that we would follow Jesus. That's eight people. That's eight people who were carried to the feet of Jesus, not by the faith of this 40-some-odd-year-old man who had been healed, not even really by the faith of this 10-year-old boy who believed the words of those stories, but by the faith of a Canadian teenager who picked up a packet and believed that if she carried this kid to the feet of Jesus, he just might do one of those miraculous works of healing that she had heard rumor of. And that's what he does. He finishes the works he starts. I want to be a part of that. I want to trust that it's my responsibility to do as best I can with the strength that I'm given to carry my friends to the feet of Jesus and then let Jesus do the work that Jesus does. And what I'm inviting you into this morning is manifold, but it's basically this. What's it look like for you to carry the folks around you? That's going to take place in a couple of different ways. I'm going to bet that there are folks who are on your mind even now. Folks in whose lives you are uniquely postured to be a carrier. To say, I've got you for this season. What's it look like for you to extend yourself to a roommate, to a parent, to a cousin, to that friend that maybe everyone quit on already, and say, I will carry you for a season? See, that's part of the gift that Jesus has given the world is you, your strength, your past. What if your woundedness in your past and the healing that came on the other side of that woundedness is in fact an opportunity for you to step into the life of someone right now who is living in that woundedness and doesn't know that there's hope for them? So, this morning before you leave, I would love for you to visit the table. This is another way to potentially do that. And if God's on your heart asking you to do this, fantastic. I'm not pushing you, hey, sponsor a kid, and this is the only way to respond. For my life, this is a way that my wife and I have practiced knowing that, like, we have something to offer the world. We have something to offer a world full of kids who need to be picked up and carried to the feet of Jesus, and that Jesus knows exactly what to do with people once they get there. So, I'm going to invite the band back.
Thank you.
And I'd love to wrap up the morning with a song and an encouragement. Would you guys stand with me?
As we're working our way through the song, let's just let the Spirit of Jesus search our hearts and our minds. How do we live this out? How does this as a theological truth, how does this as a notion actually, how does this become actualized in our lives? What's it look like for you and I to carry one another? Does it look like this morning that you get to quite literally pick up a packet and sponsor a kid who needs to be carried to the feet of Jesus? Is there someone in your life that you've been uniquely postured to carry in this season? Let the Spirit of Jesus search your heart and call you to action.
All the poor and powerless, all the lost and lonely, all the thieves will come confess and know that you are holy. Know that you are holy. And all will sing out hallelujah, and we will cry out. All who heard with nothing left. Know that you are holy. Though we sing out hallelujah, we will cry out hallelujah. Though we sing out hallelujah, we will cry.
Shout it.
Shout it. Go on and scream it from the mountain. Go on and tell it to the masses. He is God. The poor and powerless, all the lost and lonely, all the thieves that come confess, know that you are holy. Yes. Know that you
walked out of the hut. We got to the road. And it had been a long day, and it had been a little bit exhausting. I'm going to flip all the way back through here and find this picture. And because there are two seasons in India. I don't know if you know this. There's hot and are you kidding me? So we were just kind of toasty, and it had been emotionally trying, and we heard this little voice behind us. As we hit the road, after all this trial and translation, this little voice behind us said, "Thank you for coming to our home. It was very nice to meet you," in perfect English. And I turn around, and it is, where's the image? It is Deepalder's sister, who's this sneaky little brat down here in the left corner. That's Deepalder's sister, who had been in the hut with us the entire time. And my first question should have been, how did you learn to speak English so well, young girl? But it was instead, why did you not help me? She said, you did fine. I said, no, I didn't. I don't know what your standards are for Americans in, like, international discourse, but that was terrible. So the pastor of our church, of the church, says to her, because she's not sponsored, she's sister of a kid who sponsors, he says, Savita, what, why don't you tell Justin what you would like to do with your life? She says, oh, I want to run a bank. I was like, wow. You want to run a bank? Now, she's a girl who, again, is a member of that Dalit caste, a member of a people who are, like, on paper, worth less than cows and dogs. And she's a woman in a culture that generally considers women second-class citizens. So where does a kid like that who grows up in a mud hut get the notion that she can run a bank where wealthy people get their money? Here's where. The mother of that 16-year-old girl who sponsors her brother runs a bank in Canada. See, there's no default setting on the human mind. You and I believe what we believe about ourselves and about our world because we are either convinced by the better or lesser voices in our lives and in our culture. You believe what you believe about yourself because you've either been loved to that place or have been abused to that place. And we get to be a better voice in the lives of the people around us who've been told a whole lot of lies about who they are. Can I get an amen? Amen. So whether that's a parent, whether that's your roommate, whether that's one of the kids on the table over here this morning, be a better voice. Be someone who carries another person in faith to the feet of Jesus. This morning, I just want to say thank you, not only for having me here. If you choose to sponsor a kid, I brought a bunch of books of mine, and I would just extend to you and say thanks and hand you a copy of one of my books, only because of this. I believe in this work for you and I believe in this work for the world. I literally do believe that you are the gift that Jesus gave, and I want to encourage you to step into that role in whatever capacity you choose to do so. Will you pray with me? Lord Jesus, you didn't just send a message in the sky. You sent your son. You sent yourself. You showed up in the flesh and gave yourself to us. May we follow suit. May we give ourselves not just in mind, not just in body, not just in spirit, but entirely to the world. May we recognize the gift of ourselves to this world and be encouraged that we are the way you have answered so many of these cultural, philosophical questions of what does justice look like? How do things get fixed? What does reconciliation look like? How do we come to peace? We are the ones that answer that question in the way we live our lives and the way we give ourselves to our world and to one another. Thank you for the goodness that is you, and thank you for letting us share in that goodness. We are blessed. We want to be a blessing. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Have a wonderful morning.